What is going on your Instagram?
Husband says I'm a crow because anything that glitters or sparkles, I'm like, that's it.
Teachers who are tired and stressed can't be at their best for their students.
And I'm a firm believer that there's a place for technology, but not with early learners.
I have a custom-made red guitar. It's fully sparkled out. Are we perhaps misdiagnosing some of these students and saying, hey, these students belong in the, where they actually do not belong in the special education category? Never met a teacher who's said, oh no, I've never spent money out of my pocket.
You're doing anything and everything to engage your students and bring the next level to learning.
Is it true that you've never cut or trimmed your hair? Hello and welcome. We have a very special guest today on our show, Miss Abigail Peterson, also known as Kindergarten Chaos, who's been a teacher for over 12 years. With over 100,000 followers, Abigail provides incredible content to teachers when it comes to fun activities to use in a kindergarten classroom. Don't miss out on this amazing interview where we talk about teacher burnout, homeschooling, problems with school administration, teachers pay teachers, Diet Coke, and all things glittery. Hi, Abigail. I wanted to welcome you to our show. Thank you so much for joining me today. So you're known as Kindergarten Chaos on social media, and your Instagram is also filled with beautiful pictures of supplies and arts and craft. Now, the first thing I need to know is what is going on your Instagram? It's super, super cool. I'm going to go ahead and share you my screen over here. Mm-hmm. Here's the first picture we need to discuss and talk about. It's super awesome. So over here, I found two incredible and awesome pictures. Let's go ahead and start off. First of all, I think let's start off with the right picture first over here. So this is can you please explain what's going on here?
So as most elementary school teachers know, we love dress up weeks and days. And throughout the school year, there is usually several weeks where there are spirit weeks or dress up weeks for different events. So it might be the week before winter break. It's usually the week of reading week, National Reading Week. And then sometimes there's like a drug awareness and they have all these theme days. Well, this was a crazy hair day. And I have super long hair. And so I got this idea to basically make it look like A&W root beer was coming out of my head. And so the kids love it. It's a lot of fun. And I always try to switch it up and do something different every single spirit day that we had. So that's where that picture came from.
That's incredible. And I want to fact check myself on this because I'm not exactly sure if this is true or not. Is it true that you've never cut or trimmed your hair?
No, I have not.
Wow.
No.
Wow. That is super, super interesting. That is
totally random fact.
That's an incredible fact, honestly. Okay, so that's really cool. And I have to applaud you, by the way, because if that was me and if I were a teacher in the classroom, I would probably reuse the same outfit for like the next 20 years. It takes an enormous amount of energy for me to come up with creative ideas. So I loved browsing through your Instagram pictures and just like every other post was something so fascinating. So I really appreciate that, what you do for your students, because it does make a big difference. But I do want to talk about the other picture over here. So it looks like I'm assuming those are real dollar bills. Is that correct?
They are real dollar bills. Dollar bills. So like you said, I always love to take it up a notch and always do something different, not the same thing when it would come to these spirit days. And so this particular day is a day that is celebrated a lot in kindergarten and first grade classrooms. It's the 100th day of school. And so on the 100th day of school, there's a myriad of activities that can be done and are done. And one of the fun activities that I would do in the classroom was have the students create a 100-day shirt with 100 different things on it. So it could be stickers, you know, so that way it could be removed. I had families that would actually do like puffy paint or all different kinds of things. You can even buy shirts that say like 100 days of school and it has 100 gumballs on it. So there's a lot of ways to do it. But this year I was like, okay, I want to do something totally different. And I thought, okay, what if I had like $100 bills? Like that would be so cool. And so I had to come up with a way to actually pin $100 bills on. And to actually pin 100 $1 bills, there wouldn't have been enough room. So I came up with this little pinwheel design. And it was the talk of the school that day. It was a lot of fun. And there you have it. That's the story.
Wow. So those dollar bills were pinned. I was, for some reason, as you can see, I'm not so creative. I thought that they were glued in or something like that. So my next question was going to be, were you able to reuse those dollars? Thank goodness you did not use glue. But someone like me, if I had that idea, it would have been glue. And then I would, you know.
Would have been a big hot mess.
Exactly. Okay, so now before we move on to some more questions over here, I do have something special next to me. Now, digging through your Instagram, I know that you're a fan of diet. Is it Coke or Pepsi or anything diet?
So it was anything diet. Now, let me tell you a funny story about this. When I was growing up, my parents, you know, this would have been in the 80s, and a lot of women in the 70s and 80s were Weight Watcher, you know, in the diet craze. And so when I was growing up, I'm the youngest of three. My parents only had diet soda. They did not have any regular soda. So if I ever had soda, it was only diet. So I acquired a taste for diet. And anytime I drink anything that is filled with regular sugar, it's disgusting to me. So I just carried that into adulthood. And then I became a connoisseur of what I prefer. So my preferred is Diet Pepsi Max. So that is my preferred one, but I'll drink any of them.
Okay. So if we put you to a blind taste test, you would be able to distinguish that versus, let's say, a Diet Coke that I have in front of me?
To some extent, yes. But you know what's really interesting is the McDonald's Diet Coke is actually delicious and tastes different than the bottle or the can.
I agree with you 100%. And I don't know if I should be saying this, but I literally just tried that maybe like 2 weeks. Oh, well, I had it 2 weeks ago. I don't know what McDonald's does, but their diet, something different, which makes no sense, honestly. Okay, so thank you for that, Abigail. I want to go ahead and move in and talk about, we were talking about how you have all these cool arts and crafts and supplies in your Instagram story. Now, when you were a teacher, because you're currently not an active teacher, but you've been a teacher for over 12 years. You've been teaching kindergarten for about 11 years, I believe. And then you've also taught second grade for a year when you first started out. Mm-hmm. I wanted to ask, and I'm sure this number kind of varies year to year, but how much money out of pocket were you typically spending? Were you spending money out of pocket for your classroom in the given year?
Absolutely. I do not know of any teachers that are not able to spend their own money. Especially when it comes to elementary, because you're doing anything and everything to engage your students and bring the next level to learning. And that takes things. And I actually graduated in 2004 with my bachelor's in elementary education. So I've been in education a long time, not always currently in the classroom, but always working in education. And in the almost 20 years that I've been in education, it is becoming more challenging to engage students. And there's a lot of reasons for that. But in doing so, that requires things. And when I say things, it doesn't, some teachers can say, well, it doesn't. Yes, you can use paper, you can use file folders. That is one thing I also try to share on my Instagram and on my social media platform, is creating ideas that doesn't require you to spend money. But for instance, in my classroom, I was a big believer in flexible seating. And so I purchased wobble stools, and I call them little toadstools, the little ones from IKEA. And those all cost money. But the benefit for my students and what I found to be in the classroom was greater than the few dollars that I was going to spend. So I spent a lot of money. And if you think about, you know, the holiday time of year or or Mother's Day time of year or end of the year, teachers a lot of times spend their own money for kids to create gifts, because the school a lot of times doesn't supply that. It's very rare that a school does. So if a classroom, a teacher wants her kids to go home with a gift for their families, or a gift at Mother's Day or Father's Day, or for, you know, Parents' Day, Grandparents' Day, or end of the year, a lot of times teachers pay for that out of their pocket. So it's a lot of money.
Yeah, I'm not going to actually ask you how much money you typically spend, but, you know, the National Education Association just came out with some data in October of 2022 stating that this year, on average, educators are spending $800 on average out of pocket in school supplies, which is just insane to think about, because we, you know, there's some common topics that we can always talk about in the teaching industry. It's underpaid. And now you have to, you know, talk about things like, hey, I have to go out of my paycheck and now fulfill these supplies. I've never met a teacher who's said, oh, no, I've never spent money out of my pocket. And when you think about different industries, it's completely the opposite, because you get reimbursed for everything. So that's a very interesting topic. And fortunately, I hope that there will be some things that can progress in this on this particular issue. I do know that the IRS has finally increased their educator expense deduction up to $300. It was $250 expense forever. Now they increased it to $300. But again, that doesn't do the job. Educators are still spending way more.
Absolutely.
So, when we think about kindergarten students, a few years ago, when I thought about kindergarten students, I think of a limited technology introduction in the classroom and outside in the home as well. I want to ask you, how has technology in your classroom evolved from back in 2014 when you were teaching to now?
So this is something I'm very passionate about, and this is something that I share in professional development, but is not probably out there in writing somewhere, but I was actually raised in a household that did not have TV. So I was raised without a TV, and that is very unusual, abnormal. So, and I have three kids personally. My oldest is married. He's 21 and married. And I have a 14-year-old and a 13-year-old and a 15-year-old. And we have chosen to not have a TV in our house as well. And because of my upbringing and my experience with being able to craft and come up imaginatively with things outside of technology, it impacted the way I was as a teacher in the classroom. And I'm a firm believer that there's a place for technology, but not with early learners. That's just a personal opinion. I think that there's plenty of time for technology. My 13 and 15-year-old, they are exposed to technology. They actually go to an online school. And so they, you know, are on computers and working with their teachers and their classmates online. And so I'm not against technology, but I think at such a young age, the inundation that has and projection that have been put on our early learners is actually impacting their learning and their abilities to think and to actually process information. And then, of course, and I can get into this, but fine motor has become a major impact. And even when I first started teaching kindergarten to my last year, which was 2020, every year the fine motor muscle skills came in weaker and weaker and weaker. And so technology has a place, but I would prefer it not to be in early childhood and early elementary classrooms.
Wow, that's such great advice. And I completely agree with you. Especially on the motor skills, the decline in that. We own a private preschool in Brooklyn. We serve over 139 students on that location, and I won't go too into detail, but we do see major issues. And I agree with you. I did have a TV growing up, although it was a very small TV, but I remember being able to engage myself in activities that I would come up and think about. We would take an empty water bottle, fill it up with a little bit of water, and go outside and just throw it and play catch like football, because, you know, these are things that we did as kids. And now, because we have all this media, and when you introduce students to laptops and computers and TVs, they cannot think for themselves. And that is such a good point. And
young students are no longer reading or reading as much. They can't get into it because they cannot read and imagine and play a movie of what they're reading. It's because they're so used to watching a show and everything being almost done for them.
And if you think about technology, this has always been an issue. But it's interesting, if you look at the statistics on Sesame Street from the 1970s and 1980s to the most current Cocomelon shows that are popular now, the amount that and the rate at which the images changes is one of the reasons why our children have no attention span, is because if their visual perception is not being constantly stimulated every 1 to 2 seconds, it's not enough. It's not engaging. And so if you look at old Sesame Street, where the imaging did not change and the screens did not change as fast as it does now, if you imagine taking current 4 and 5 year olds and putting them in front of a 1970s Sesame Street, it's boring because right. It's not moving as rapidly. I also want to draw your attention to one thing that I always tell parents and I always tell other beginning early education teachers. Think about this. So in the 80s and 90s and early 2000s, and like I said, my oldest is 21, he's almost 22. So he was born in 2001. So I have an experience of raising a child in the early 2000s. When you would go to family restaurants, Applebee's, Chili's, Olive Garden, wherever you go, even bar and grills, if you have a child with you, they would give you a paper placemat and crayons.
Right.
And in the last 8 years, it has transitioned to when your child comes in, they hand your child a kiosk to play a game on. This has greatly impacted that fine motor, as I spoke about before. No more are our little learners getting the opportunity to practice with crayons. It's gone away.
I did not even think about that, actually, but you are absolutely right. All these big chains now have kiosk machines, and they did have games, but I don't have children of my own or yet. But wow, that is such great insight. Wow, that is...
It's all these little things that when we talk about the problems in education and why we have struggling learners, there's a lot of things. It's not, you know, sometimes we want to pigeonhole and say, well, it's the teacher's fault or it's the school's right. fault or it's the district's fault or it's the government's fault or it's so-and-so. But there's all these little pieces that are making an impact on learning.
Right. Wow. That's thank you so much for actually bringing that to my attention. But you're right. It's all these small things that play a huge, huge impact. In this case, a negative impact. So since we're talking about students, let's go ahead and now transition slightly over into teaching. Mm-hmm. So you used to teach for Clark County School District. Is that correct? You're from Las Vegas. And Clark County School District, probably everyone knows that they are the fifth largest district, I believe, in the United States. Recently, however, or I guess it's universally across many districts, but Clark County's teacher shortage has increased 50% from 800 at the beginning of the 2021 to 2022 school year to about 1,200 teachers as of March. Now, for this school year, 2022 to 2023, the Clark County School District was roughly 1,400 teachers short, despite them trying to do pay raises and for new hires, relocation bonuses. First of all, I think it's great that they slightly bumped up the salary band, but let's be honest, it's nowhere near enough. But I do want to ask you your thoughts on this matter of this trend over here. Is the reason that teachers are simply burnt out?
I think so. I think that is, as I just spoke, I don't think it's any one particular thing. I think it's all these little things that add up to the big picture. So I think anybody, if you polled anybody on the street, anybody and everybody would agree that teachers aren't paid enough, just flat out. Okay. But most teachers, I would say 90% of teachers, did not sign up to make millions of dollars in teaching. Right. They do it because they love kids. They love teaching. They have a passion for that. They have a passion for the future, whatever it may be. They know what they're getting into when they become a teacher. So let's remove the salary portion out. What has happened over the last 10 to 15 years in education has been testing data, and all these paperwork after paperwork. There is paperwork for every single thing. You cannot do anything without having to fill out a paper and getting it approved, or just filling out paperwork after. It's all these things that cause teachers to be like, overwhelmed, feel like they can't do their job. They just want to go in and teach. Then you have the pressure on the admin, which a lot of times trickles down to the teachers. So you have the higher ups putting pressure on the admin. Your teachers need to be meeting this. They need to be meeting these map goals. They need to be hitting these standards. They're not, we're the lowest in the country or we're the second lowest in the country. So then these admin tighten the reins on teachers. And then you feel like you're a robot and you cannot do what's best for children. And so it's a whole combination of all these little things, and teachers feel like, I just can't do it anymore.
Wow. Yeah. When we think about teachers traditionally, like anyone who's not a licensed teacher or has experience in the classroom, we would think, hey, as a teacher, you just go in, you work on your lesson plan, you prepare whatever the case is, and you go in and you teach and you love what you do because you're teaching students and you love that. But as you're mentioning now, there is a lot of other outside things that puts a lot of pressure. As you mentioned, paperwork for everything you do.
Everything.
For admin, pressure from principals. And of course, they're getting the pressures from their district leaders as well. And there's so many testing and so many things.
And we didn't even bring in the parent part, because that is something that I'm hearing frequently.
Can you clarify? What do you mean by
that? So the parent part is, in a private school in a private school, you have the option, parents have to sign contracts and, keep up with what the private school, their rules and their regulations. But in a public school and even a charter school, you don't have that option. So we serve everybody in a public school. Same with a charter school. You're getting government funds. You have some leeway in the curriculum you choose and, your teachers, but you are still have to serve everybody. And parents, especially since 2020, have become extremely critical of teachers. And we have big controversies over what's allowed in the classroom and what's not allowed. And you're not doing it right. And you should be teaching this or you shouldn't be teaching this. And so you have all these, all these extra components from parents. And then there is I wouldn't necessarily call it a revolution, but I would say that it's a problem and almost like an epidemic in society of nobody wants to take responsibility for behaviors.
Right.
It's a big, challenging problem. If you as a teacher can't have adequate support from your admin because the parents come in and create problems, how do you handle classroom management?
Right.
How, if there's no responsibility or all the blame is put on you as a teacher, it's no wonder teachers are leaving.
Wow. That's a lot. That's a really good point. That's a really good point. And I do think as a society, as a community, I should say, we have become more divided and both sides have completely different views. And I can completely see that as parents coming up to you and say, hey, why is this in the curriculum? Mm-hmm. Why did my child come with this particular question on page 32? Mm-hmm. So yeah, it's crazy.
Let's add one more thing to the mix. We know that inclusion in classrooms is important for students who have IEPs, but the amount of IEPs that are now being created for students has significantly increased in special education, and there's not enough special education teachers. And so I'll give you an example firsthand. My last year in the public school classroom, so it was the 2019-2020 school year, I had 29 kindergarten students, no assistant, no aide, no paras. We don't have that in the Clark County School District. So 29 students, and 11 of them had IEPs. So that means that they all have an individual educational plan that has to be followed by federal law, not state law, not your county or your district, but by federal law, it has to be followed. And so I'm supposed to service all 29 of my students, but these ones have special needs and have special accommodations. How am I supposed to meet those needs? How when there's not enough special education teachers, I don't have enough, there's not enough people, there's not enough minutes in the day to have people push in or for students to be pulled out and meet the needs. Then you talk about the behavior issues that are on IEPs or 504s, and those behaviors impact other students. And then again, brings that circle back all the way around with parents saying, well, I don't understand why this student's getting away with it and my student can't. So these are all little pieces, all little breadcrumbs to why teachers leave.
I want to talk more about a little bit more about, since you brought it up, about IEPs. So New York State is literally like the number one state with the most number of students enrolled in special education with IEPs, with these individualized learning plans. I read a couple of great articles where it's just a trend now. It's not, it's that so many more students are coming into the school system and they're being put on IEP plans. So I don't know if you know the answer to this, but I think it's interesting. Someone brought a good, this article made a very good point is, are we perhaps misdiagnosing some of these students and saying, hey, these students belong in the, where they actually do not belong in the special education category? Or is it that because of all these little things that have been going on and the pandemic and these increased bad behavior where actually, no, these students do belong in this particular program and they need an IEP plan. What are your thoughts? Because this has been a very interesting topic in the education space.
So, of course, I'm going off of my own personal experience in the classroom and then where I'm at currently in education, and that is interacting with new beginning teachers and teachers that are just securing their licenses. So I'm still very active in education. I have a very close relationship with my former principal, who's still a principal in our school district. So I do stay up to date on what is happening. And I will tell you that in the last 3 to 4 years since 2020 and a little bit before, there's been, again, a huge increase in emotional issues, which is why SEL education has become so relevant in schools everywhere. And then you have also trauma-informed teaching. So you have a lot of kids that are coming to school with a lot of issues. Now, is there a true diagnosis, like you said, or is it just issues that parents are not dealing with at home? Or I'll give you another example. ADD and ADHD gets thrown around a lot. And as an educator, I cannot diagnose a child. I am not legally allowed to. I can't even say those words. Mm-hmm. So, but what happens is, again, you take kids who for 3 years or 4 years at home, I'm not talking about when they were one and a baby, but you know, from age 18 months to when they enter school, they are constantly being stimulated by technology. Constantly, you know, the funny thing is in my classroom, I had old school, like desktop computers. And you know what? The first thing they want to do when they sit down is touch the screen because they're used to everything being touch screen.
Okay.
Well, in schools that don't have budgets and you have old school where you have to have a mouse, you're like, no, honey, you got to use a mouse. And they don't know how to use it because they're used to touch screen.
Wow.
And so you have all these kids that have come from constantly being stimulated to all of a sudden now they have to sit and they have to attain to a task for 5 minutes. That is very challenging. They don't want to. They're not used to that. They're used to their parent or their caregiver just giving them a phone or giving them some sort of technology to stimulate them, or they getting to do whatever they want to do. And they're not having to learn. And that's what I loved about teaching kindergarten was being able to set that foundation and kind of teach them how to attain to a task and how to listen for a certain amount of time. The research also shows it's 1 minute per attention span. I mean, one minute of age per attention span. So you're looking to 5 to 6 minutes is about what a 5-year-old can do. It taps out at about 13 to 15 minutes for all adults. So if you think about yourself, if you go to a church service or you go to a funeral, after about 15 minutes of sitting there and listening, you got to shift your mind a little bit. So like you'll dig in your purse, you'll look at the time on your phone, you'll look at your watch, that kind of resets your brain. So we have all these students who are coming in who don't know how to regulate themselves. They don't know how to, attain to a task. So then that automatically becomes this panic of, your child's not being able to sit. Well, they must have ADD. They must have ADHD. Right. And then we're running to pediatricians and pediatricians are overwhelmed. And so it's like here, 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 here. And I think there is an overabundance of IEPs that are not necessary. But again, that's a personal, just a personal opinion. And but we do not have the structure and framework in public schools to handle the amount of IEPs and special needs that are coming in.
Wow. So obviously we're talking about a lot of issues and problems. I want to turn our attention. I know this is like almost like a depressing conversation.
I apologize. No, we'll get, let me tell you the positives.
it's very important to talk about these issues because all teachers know it, but the general public should be aware of this. The engineers, the doctors, the parents, the not the parents, the future students that are 18 years old and about to go to college and change the world. I mean, we need to be aware of this because there needs to be, I guess, many, there will never be one, but many different small and big solutions to really kind of help this. But I do want to focus and shift very quickly to talk about the teacher pipeline. As we just mentioned, teachers are burnt out. A lot of teachers are quitting. It's not a critical issue yet, but it may become a critical issue. I wanted to ask you, what advice in your particular expertise that you have teaching all these years, what advice can you give to district leaders to help attract undergrad students to go into teaching, right? Because now I'm thinking about the pipeline, the beginning pipeline, which is getting students in to even enter this profession now. Mm-hmm. And, you know, as all these students are watching TikTok and they see teachers hate their lives, mm-hmm. not all teachers hate their lives, teaching is a changing career. But what advice can you give to those leaders to, you know, make sure they're getting a healthy number of students into these classes to become a licensed professional to teach students?
Well, your question is directed towards admin. So I'm going to address that. And then if you want me to address the teachers, I'll do that as well. So when it comes to admin, I think a good admin that is trying to bring teachers into their building, I think they need to allow teachers to have a healthy form of autonomy, meaning that when you put all these restraints on teachers and you say, you can't do this and 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 you got to do it exactly like this, and that pulls that autonomy away. And every teacher has their own teacher personality. And so allowing teachers to present information or to, you know, decorate their classroom or use different resources, I think is a very important part of education and important for admin to allow those teachers to find their teacher voice, find their teacher personality, because sometimes you think you're going to be, it's like becoming a parent. Well, I think I'm going to be a parent like this. And then you get in there and you find out, you know, like, oh, well, that wasn't exactly what I meant. You know, I find I'm more on this side or that, you know, so I think supporting teachers. Okay. Here's something else. Why are schools charging teachers to wear jeans?
I'm sorry. Teachers are being charged to wear jeans in the classroom. Can you clarify on that? Okay. Again, I'm not a teacher, so I don't know.
But, I mean, so there are a lot of districts throughout the United States that have very strict, specific dress codes and And so they say you cannot wear jeans, but then they'll have a special Jean Friday, and if you pay $5, you can wear your jeans.
So, my head hurts. I apologize. So it's a Friday. It's a special day. It's Jeans Day. So you get to wear. So Miss Peterson, you're teaching kindergarten. You want to celebrate in Jeans Day, but you have to pay $5 to the school to participate.
So there are a lot of schools that still participate and they all have different versions of it. So it's not, it's not a one, you know, it's not this secret Jeans Day fund or anything. It's just every school operates differently, but it's amazing to me that we're still, you know, not, what does it matter? I mean, you're dealing, especially, you know, you have special education classrooms and you have inclusion classrooms where these teachers are chasing after kids, are on the floor, are cleaning up throw up because that's a part of their job. And they have to wear, you know, dress shoes and a shirt and tie. And I'm not against looking professional, but I think we set up these standards that are just not realistic and are just not accurate. And so going back to what I was saying, when admin have these rules in place, that for what? For who is it benefiting the kids? No. And I think sometimes we get tunnel vision, or admin get tunnel vision, and they don't see the bigger picture, which is we're here for the kids. We're right. here for the students. We're here to teach. The students do not care if I am wearing a hoodie right. or right. a button-down shirt, you know? So admin, let's bring into focus, what is the purpose? Let's strip right. away as many of these things that are hindering teachers and holding right. them back as we can. So in regards to your question about what can admin do, they really need to reexamine themselves and their purpose and their tunnel vision, and think about, these teachers are trying, there's no teacher I know that's like, well, I'm going to be the worst teacher and I'm going to do what's terrible for kids. There's no teacher that says that. We all want to see, you know, our students be successful. So right. allow those teachers the autonomy and start peeling away all these things that are hindering teachers.
Wow. That is some great advice. And this is my first time hearing this. This is why I love speaking to teachers. I mean, you think you know the field of education. I mean, our experience is from a whole different point of view, but this is why I really enjoy these interviews and just learning. I mean, this is the first time I've heard it. Every teacher is probably like, my school does, how do you not know this?
Yeah.
But thank you for sharing that. I really appreciate that. I do know, so I mentioned, I know that you taught second grade very briefly, for a whole school year, and then transitioned to kindergarten. I'm assuming you fell in love with it. Can you talk really quickly about second grade experience and then going to kindergarten and your kind of burning passion for that grade level?
So my very first year of teaching, I was hired to teach second grade. I didn't have a preference. And this is, I'm going to kind of do a 2-for-1 here. I'm going to kind of give a little bit of advice if you are somebody who's in education. The best thing that I could have ever done was when I came to my practicums, and every school and a university calls it something different. But when it came to my practicums, which I did 2 semesters, and you go like twice a week for 3 hours. So 2 different semesters of that. And then you do one, or my UNLV, I did 1 semester of student teaching, which is every day, all day, where you're learning how to operate and teach in the classroom. So a lot of teachers, or a lot of pre-teachers, people who are wanting to get an education, they have this mindset, again, kind of going back to the parent, well, I'm going to be this. I only want to teach second grade, or I only want to teach fifth grade, or I only want to teach kindergarten. Well, in a lot of school districts, and especially here in Clark County School District, you don't get a choice. Like, you don't sign up for a certain grade.
Right.
They call you and say, would you like to interview for a third grade position? Would you like to, you know, we have a fourth grade position. And so the best thing that I ever did was my first practicum, I was in a kindergarten classroom. And then my second practicum, because they ask you your first and second, third choices. And so I had methodically thought this out. I said, okay, I want to have an experience across all elementary, because I don't know where I'm going to land.
Right.
So my first practicum was in kindergarten. My second practicum was in third grade, and my student teaching was in fifth. So okay. I really got a chance to kind of see those early learners and then those that are on their way to middle school. And so I got hired to teach second grade, and I was like, yay, I don't have to teach them how to read and write, and I don't have to do state testing, you know? And so I was like, it's kind of like the perfect first year for me. So I love teaching second grade. But then I had little kids at the time, and I wanted to try something part-time. Not be full. I wanted to be able to be home with my kids a little bit. And so we had a new principal. And at that time, our district had half day kindergarten. And now we have full day, and most of the country is full day. But at that time we had half days, and our school was a smaller school, less than 500 students. So we only had enough students, kindergarten students, for 3 kindergarten classrooms. Well, that means 1 full-time teacher and then 1 half-time teacher.
Okay.
So I was able, he's like, if you want to work half-time, the only thing I have is kindergarten. And I was like, I don't know how to teach kids how to read and write, you know? So I don't know if I want to do this, but this was my only opportunity. And the very first day and this is the crazy thing, was I got called on Friday afternoon. I got called on Friday morning, and the teacher was Friday afternoon.
Okay.
And the first day of school was Monday. So I literally had 72 hours to pull together a classroom.
Wow.
And so on the first day after the students left, I was like, this is my passion. Like, I loved it. And I knew this is where I'm meant to be.
Wow. That is such a great story. And I'm a huge believer you are meant to be for that, because when I scroll down all those posts that you have on social media, I mean, you are a rock star. I mean, that is incredible. Like, that is the, when I envision an amazing kindergarten teacher, that's literally what I imagine, which is you, because I see your videos, I see your posts, I see all these fun little crafts and strategies that you have mm-hmm. to teach. Students. I was looking at a video where you were teaching them how to identify letters with a black, like a construction paperboard, with a white piece of paper to act as a flashlight. I mean, mm-hmm. that's incredible. And kids do, I mean, adults do still have memories of their kindergarten teacher and their experience in the classroom. I remember my kindergarten teacher, not vividly, not a lot, but I do. And I also remember my time in the classroom. And I remember that there was one girl I even liked.
Yeah.
Kindergarten, you see, like I'm now 29 years old, but I still have memories. So mm-hmm. teachers play such an impactful role. But thank you for that. And you are definitely meant to be. And all those years teaching kindergarten, you've done an incredible job.
And you have the choice. And this is what I tell new teachers, is you have a choice to, and especially in kindergarten, which is, you know, there are some kids that do go to preschool or daycare setting, but there are still a lot of kids that do not have any educational experience before they come into the mm-hmm. kindergarten classroom. So we are that first experience, and especially in that formal sense of education, we are that first experience. And we have an opportunity as a kindergarten teacher to make or break a student. And what I mean by that is, my personal kindergarten memory was when I was five, I had a wart on my thumb.
Okay.
And warts are not contagious, but this teacher must have thought it was, and she would not allow me to pass out papers because I had a wart on my thumb. So my mom went and had it froze off, and I never forgot that. That was one of my memories from kindergarten, was that. And so you have an opportunity to make or break students. And I always said to my principal and my admin, I said, if my students at the end of the kindergarten year are excited to go into first grade, then I have done my job, because 100%. They have a long academic road ahead of them if they hate school after kindergarten.
Right.
So my mantra has always been intentionally teaching, because we have standards we have to teach, and we have to be intentional about what we're teaching. It has to be purposeful. You know, sometimes that people can get into a habit of things that don't have any purpose. And there is a place for that. You know, there is a place for that. But in the forefront of a kindergarten teacher, in my mind, is intentionally teaching with purpose and fun, because it all can be done. It all can be done. And again, my students left at the end of the year excited to go to first grade. They were sad to leave my classroom, but they were happy. They were happy to go into first grade. And I did my job.
That is such great advice. And that is really good advice for teachers going into teaching, like teachers that are planning to go into the school year. Make sure that your students are going to look forward to going to first grade. That is a very good metric to see if you have done your job as a kindergarten teacher and if you're fun enough / engaging and all that kind of fun stuff. Wow, that's some really good advice. Now, I do want to talk a little bit about homeschool. So obviously, we're now out of the pandemic, thankfully. Obviously, there's been a lot of issues that have come up because of this, but we do see a lot more families who now homeschool their children. Now, I do know that you were homeschooled from 8th grade to 12th grade, I believe. Right?
I was.
Mm-hmm. I just want to learn a little bit more about your experience being homeschooled. Did you attend like public school beforehand? I just kind of want to know a little bit more details about that story.
So I was in public school from kindergarten to 5th grade, and we actually lived in Orlando at the time. And so I was in public school, same school, my whole elementary career. And then we actually moved out here to Las Vegas right before middle school. And so middle school, I think anybody, if you take a poll, anybody and everybody will probably say it's not a nice time. Kids are in that time where they're transitioning to young adults, and there's just a lot of things that go on in middle school that, you know, a lot of, you know, there's a lot that goes on in middle school. I don't think anybody wants to go back and relive middle school anytime soon. But, and so, I went into a public school, sixth and seventh grade here, and my parents, after after my seventh grade. I am one of those people and was one of those kids that wanted to be involved in everything. So there wasn't, I wanted to be a part of every club. And my parents just kind of saw me going down a road that they weren't, that they thought probably wasn't in my best interest. And so my sister, again, I'm the youngest. My oldest sister had graduated through homeschool at 15. She just went her last, I think it was probably her last 3 years, her 10th, 11th, and 12th grade. She did it in about a year and graduated early. And so they had seen the effects of that and felt like that would have been an option for me. So I did my eighth grade year through a program that's very, it's been around for over 100 years out of Chicago. And it was the old school. They would mail me stuff. I would do the work, mail it back. They would grade it. And that was my eighth grade year. Okay. And then ninth through 12th grade, I did a different program because the previous program only went to eighth grade. And so go ahead. I know you have some questions for me.
No, I have no questions at all.
Oh, okay. So I was, but as somebody who was homeschooled, the common opposition to it is, well, you don't get that socialization. But mm-hmm. I mm-hmm. was involved very heavily in our church and in our youth group. So I had the social. I wasn't seeking social or needed the social from a school setting. Mm-hmm. So I that wasn't an issue for me. I was able to graduate early, not as early as my sister, but I was able to graduate early, and I did start college early. At the time, my parents were very thoughtful and said, you know what, you're really young. We're just going to let you go one class for one semester. And then that's kind of how I started going to school so early. But in terms of homeschool, my biggest opposition to homeschooling young children is that foundation. Everything is built on reading and writing and early numeracy. And if that foundation is not super strong, if you don't have your child will struggle. And then the other thing is people need to learn how to take instruction from other adults other than their parents.
Oh, right. Wow. So if you can give some advice, and this is just general advice, right? Mm-hmm. You're not telling every parent to go out and do this. K-5, you need some licensed educator, teacher in the room, or someone out other than yourself who knows how to teach students phonics, literacy, and all mm-hmm. those other fine motor skills and all those other foundational elements. And then perhaps, because we know a lot of our audience members are actually homeschooling families, but they start very early. So in your experience, it would say, hey, think about some kind of institution setting where your kids can learn from K-3, K-5, whatever the case is. And then if you want to homeschool, you can homeschool moving forward.
Yes and no. And let me back up just a little bit and clarify. It's been my experience in dealing with, like I said, my older sister and my older brother, both of them, my sister has two kids. She homeschooled her kids all the way. And then my brother, his two older daughters had experience in homeschool when they were in kindergarten, first grade, which is kind of where I saw that firsthand experience of the big thing with homeschool is the consistency and the stick-to-itiveness, you know, that parents have to have, you know, and if students don't have that consistency and they don't have that progress that's needed to go forward, you know, it'll detract from their learning. It'll impact where they're going. So I think if you have a strong curriculum and there are a lot of great homeschool curriculums out there. But I do think if you have the means and you have the ability to have somebody who is who knows education, who's licensed in education and can give you input or suggestions. I know there's a lot of homeschool groups out there. I think that's great. But most importantly, your kids need to be in a setting somewhere where they learn to take direction and instruction from someone other than the parent. I think that's really important because when you go into the real world, you know, if you've only ever been taught by your mom and your dad and you've only been at home, and then all of a sudden you go and you're going to get a job somewhere. And then you're like, well, why do I have to do that? And you question everything. I mean, you have to learn how to take instruction from other people. You have to learn right. how to work with other personalities and other attitudes. And that's just right. a part of life.
That's some really good advice. Now, I do want to go ahead and shift our attention over back to teachers now. And so EdWeek recently came out with a shocking statistic that more than 50% of teachers work a second job. It's a second job or a side hustle out of the classroom. Mm-hmm. What's more shocking to me personally when I was researching this is 17% of those who actually hold a job, it's unrelated to teaching. Now, I think it's fair to say we've already talked about numerous points in this mm-hmm. interview that we all universally agree that teachers are heavily underpaid. Now, when I take a look at these statistics, I think about the short-term and long-term impacts of teachers working extra jobs. Mm-hmm. EdWeek summed up the issue by stating, and they did a really good job. So they stated, teachers who are tired and stressed can't be at their best for their students. And eventually, they may not be there for them at all. Mm-hmm. Teachers who have a lower base salaries are not only more likely to supplement their teacher pay with earnings outside of the school system, they're also more likely to quit their jobs. Now, we've talked about teachers and teacher salaries already earlier on, so I want to talk about a platform that has been amazing for many teachers to earn supplemental income, which mm-hmm. is Teachers Pay Teachers. Yes. For those, and we're not a sponsor or affiliated or anything like that with Teachers Pay Teachers, but it's a very well-known platform. Almost every teacher knows yes. about them. But for those who are not familiar with our audience, with TPT, Teachers Pay Teachers, it's an online marketplace for educational resources, worksheets, and lesson plans where teachers can either buy or even sell their own materials. Mm-hmm. I personally love that Teachers Pay Teachers has been able to provide teachers a way to make additional income. Can you talk about your experience on the TPT platform?
So my experience started actually prior to actually even knowing about TPT was I had a family blog back when blogs were very popular in the early 2000s. I started a family blog, just blogging my personal kids. And as I started blogging, I started, having random companies reach out to me and say, we'll send you this, we'll send you that. And so when I started teaching kindergarten, I said, well, what a great way, to integrate kindergarten. So I tried integrating kindergarten into this lifestyle family blog, and it didn't work because teachers were not there to read recipes, and right. people that were there to read recipes were not there for kindergarten teaching tips. So right. I started a completely separate blog, Kindergarten Chaos, and I was just blogging. I was just writing, sharing pictures and ideas and things. And I actually worked with a teacher who was like, have you ever considered, sharing on TPT? And I was like, no, I do not know how to do that. I do not want to do that. And then I got to thinking, I'm like, well, I can, I have all these ideas. I'm very creative. I do have a passion for teaching and sharing. And so why not? Why not try this? And so I jumped in and I started creating my own products or resources and started, I was creating for my classroom anyway, so why not share on Teachers Pay Teachers? Right. And so that's where it's a great opportunity for teachers that are already using resources that, to share, and makes it easy for other teachers because, it's tried and true. It's connected to a standard. You don't have to mail anything. There's no postage. It's all downloadable. And, right. And it's been a great platform for me. I've been on there since 2015. So that was the first year that I actually joined, was January 1st of 2015. And I've been able to grow my my audience and, my family, so to speak, of teachers that follow me. And I am very niche-based, mm-hmm. kindergarten, because that's what I've taught. And so
right.
If you're a first grade teacher and you want to purchase from me, great. If you want to follow me for all of my free ideas, great. But I mainly adhere to the kindergarten standards.
Yeah, I did take a look at your TPT store, and you have some fantastic resources out there. So anyone who's watching, whether you're a teacher, whether you're a homeschooled family, Abigail has incredible resources that are tailored for kindergarten mm-hmm. and a lot of fun activities. I did take a look at your store. And yeah, and it takes a lot of work, right? Because there's a lot of work and energy and effort that goes behind, building up your audience, but not only that, but resources as well, right?
Yes, because as I have already previously stated, for me, it's intentionally teaching with purpose and fun. So it has to have all those elements. Basically, I'm able to do multiple things at the same time. So a lot of my resources, for instance, punch cards, having little learners use a hole puncher is extremely beneficial for strengthening those fine motor muscles. Mm-hmm. Fine motor muscles. And so if we want, if I have these little ones that are coming to me who are struggling holding pencils or do not have the stamina to write for, I need to strengthen those fine motor muscles. Well, how do you do that? Right. And so let's give them opportunities to where they're learning. So it's a purposeful activity. They're punching out the letters that, you know, so if it's the letter D, they're finding all the D's, they're highlighting them and they're punching them or cutting. All of these things have multi-purpose and not just, you know, so it's very thoughtful. It's aligned to the standards. It's aligned to what kindergartners need to be successful in order to move on to the next level.
Awesome. Now I do have two quick last questions for you. So you mentioned you live in Las Vegas, right? You've lived there for a long time. I really wanted to ask you, how do you deal with the heat? Because I've been there several times. I love Las Vegas. It's very cool. I have to go there for conferences a bunch of times. But, oh man, I think the last time I went there was August. I was dying. So it's a very important question I want to ask you.
It's so funny because I've lived here the majority of my life. And I think it's like if you go down to, you know, Florida, which I lived for 6 years, or if you go somewhere where you're like, we have no humidity here. Our humidity is
right.
Extremely
it's dry.
Low. Yes,
right.
The dry
right.
heat.
Right.
So if you go and you're like, I can't, you get used to it. You get used to it. You know, you put a frog in a pan of boiling water, he's going to jump out. That's you right. when you come to Vegas. But if you put a frog in a pan of cool water and warm it up, he'll stay there.
Right.
So you just get used to it. And honestly, and this is what I tell people, we have about 3 months out of the year where it's hot. And the rest of the year, it's very nice. I mean, I can walk out right now. And so we're in December and I can get by with just wearing a hoodie, don't have to wear boots, don't have to deal with snow and scrapers and ice and all that. But during those 3 months, most of the time, unless you are somebody who works outside, you're in and out of buildings and your car's air conditioned, which is also very different from like New York where you do like mass transportation. But here we have cars, they're air conditioned. You go into buildings that are air conditioned. So you really don't deal with it. So that's how we deal with it.
That's awesome. And last question I have for you here is, I understand your favorite color, and maybe it changed, but your favorite color is glitter. Is that still true?
My husband says I'm a crow because anything that glitters or sparkles, I'm like, that's it. That's it. I do love sparkly. I do like a good sparkle.
Okay. Oh, I'm really disappointed that I have the wrong watch on me, but I'm actually a huge fan of sparkle and glitter as well. I have a custom made red guitar. It's fully sparkled out.
An
aventurine dial watch, which I'm not wearing today. I'm really disappointed in myself. I knew that beforehand. I should have brought that on to show on the camera, but I think everyone who knows me knows that I like, so my favorite color used to be red, but I'm going to change that. And anytime someone asks me now what my favorite color is, it's going to
say glitter.
I think it's a great answer.
Yes.
Abigail, thank you so much for being here today with me. Kindergarten Chaos, you are an incredible educator. Thank you for being an amazing kindergarten teacher. I truly mean that. When I scroll down your Instagram, your posts, your videos, the way you teach, every kindergarten teacher should exude the same kind of confidence and enthusiasm for children in the classroom. Thank you so much for being here. It was such a pleasure to speak with you.
Thank you for having me. I really enjoyed it. Thank you for doing your homework. You were an excellent interviewer. I've done several of these and your deep dive was pretty good because there are some questions that I was like, oh, how does he know this? So appreciate the conversation and allowing me to answer as I believe, and my passion for education and my passion for new teachers, current teachers, teachers that want to come into the profession. Find your passion, find your voice, and do what's best for kids.
That's such good advice. Thank you very much.